open, it's open process. So any interested person can participate in the work, know what is being decided, and make his or her voice heard on the issue. Individual participation, membership is not formal. We are a fellowship of individuals rather than organizations, companies, governments, or interest groups. Technical responsibility is a principle. The fellowship accepts responsibility for all aspects of the Ethereum protocol specification. The fellowship may also take responsibility for related specifications proposed to it in the future. Another principle is technical competence. The fellowship seeks consensus on proposals where we have the necessary competence. The fellowship is willing to listen to technically competent input from any source. Rough consensus to running code is another important principle. Consensus is not unanimity or majority vote. Rather, it is based on the combined technical judgment of our participants and our real-world experience in implementing and deploying our specifications. Do you want to speak to that principle in particular?
Because I know. Back around to it, yeah.
Okay. So practices, online presence, curated web pages, a calendar, links to useful resources, accessible discussion forums with a threaded web interface and email integration. And we have a website, ethereummagicians.org, which is a prototype of that. I'm posting that right now to the Gitter governance channel. In-person work, triennial meetings, two coordinated with DEF CON and ECC perhaps, and one in July. Meetups, discussions, presentations, hackathons, and other activities. Organizing participants on an ad hoc basis. Another practice is iterative workflow. Participants do research, gain experience, present their work, and make proposals. Proposals are discussed and reworked online and in person until consensus is reached. Now, that's it. So, do you want to review the EIP process, or do you want to?
I'll let Nick do that. Let me just speak to why I wanted this to happen. Just a little by my own experience. I've been here 2.5 years or more. I don't think I've met but a fraction of the developers. Meetings are places where we get talked at or talked at each other. Actual technical discussions happen in hallways and at dinners. And so I talk to the person next to me at dinner, or the random person I meet in a hallway, or I huddle with someone for 15 minutes and straighten out 3 months of misunderstandings online. So I saw a real need for meetings that were actually intended for developers to get together and discuss technical matters and come to some resolution on them. At dinner last night, in a discussion with Martin McKeesey, I discovered that he and I actually had almost completely different requirements for what the EVM ought to be. So this is why 1.5 and WASM looked very different, and realized there had never been a requirements document. There had never been a discussion of a requirements document. So this was missing, and there was not even any sense of what it would take to arrive at any consensus on a requirement document. And we had a concept of consensus for the protocol. A protocol absolutely depends on consensus, but that concept of consensus is complete unanimity of all the clients. But the concept of human consensus is not complete human unanimity, and we had a very funny slide that we're not able to show on that. But when you go for complete unanimity, you'll find the only thing everyone can agree on is often something nobody likes. So, just a personal story on where I was, places I first was exposed to actual consensus-based work with people. Back in the mid-'80s, I joined a direct action to try to at least temporarily shut down the Rocky Flats nuclear weapons factory a short way from my home in Colorado. Hundreds of people were going to do this. We'd organized into small affinity groups of about 5 to 10 people who were going to hang very tight together and look after each other through the action. We went through training from people on how to remain nonviolent in the face of possibly extreme provocation. And then the day before the action, we had a final meeting to get consensus on the tactics. So we had to decide what laws were we going to break, what laws were we not break, how are we going to behave when we were provoked, arrested, possibly attacked by the police. This was very important for our safety. It was important for the police's safety. It was important for the consistency of the message we were going to make. And it was a large group of people. So what we did is formed a very large circle, much larger than this one. Each affinity group chose a spokesperson, and that person would be at the rim of the circle with the affinity group and sort of a triangle behind them. So you can imagine, you know, hundreds of people arrayed like this, and a facilitator with a lot of experience was at the middle. And she kept just going around the circle, seeking agreements and disagreements. And over time, there were fewer and fewer disagreements. And as the disagreements became fewer, she started asking people who disagreed, do you just disagree, or are you going to block consensus? And this is a very important distinction between I disagree, or I disagree and I am going to block consensus. And in that action, we were able to resolve all concerns that were going to block consensus. Now, this was just a single action, so had there been any people left blocking consensus, they may have choose to simply leave the action. Had they done that, we would have had to start again to see if we had consensus to continue the action without them, or we may have said, no, we're not going to continue the action without them. So this is the important distinction to make between I disagree with it, but I respect, in our case, the technical judgment of my peers, and I will not block the consensus on this. Or I not only disagree, but in my technical judgment, this would be such a mistake that it's just simply not acceptable. And it's a difficult distinction to learn. And this is something the IETF, Internet Engineering Task Force, which is why we have an internet that actually works. It's why they have the slogan of rough consensus and running code. And I think we're in the same place. You know, the Ethereum network must run. We have to have the running code. And to evolve it, we have to have at least a rough consensus of where we're going. And I don't know if anyone was in the unfortunate panel yesterday on LASM. I lost my temper and left. And it was because we never had even rough consensus on where that was going, and technical questions I've been raising for months and never been answered. You know, I was asked to explain it at that point, and I was like, anyway. it's that kind of thing. We simply haven't had a forum discussing these sorts of things. And so I'm hoping today we can come to some rough consensus on such a forum and how we would like to organize ourselves. So we put forward the basic principles. So I'd like to see some consensus on those. They're not carved in stone. And then sort of the basics of organization, of, you know, any sort of organization of people. In fact, the first thing we haven't done here is someone to volunteer to be secretary and simply be taking notes and volunteer to type those up and make them available to everyone at the end. Hudson probably would have done that, but he wasn't able to make it.
Good.
Okay. I guess we have a recording of it also. Is that going to be available to us?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I guess it'd probably be helpful to review our, at least my understanding of how the process, or rather the hard fork process works right now, and so that we can come to consensus on that and on what the structure of the, where the appropriate place to raise different sorts of objections or to discuss different matters. So I guess I'll go over briefly my understanding of the process so people can tell me if they think I'm wrong. Effectively, the process is a standardization process similar to IETF's RFCs. And so if you want to propose a hard fork, or you know, propose a change that would require a hard fork, you write an EIP that describes the change you want to see, and you submit it to the EIP GitHub as a pull request, and you can discuss it, and that's the bit we're trying to come to consensus on here, is, you know, the best way to discuss EIPs, to standardize them, to move forward and so on. Once you've come to this, elusive consensus on technical matters, the EIP can be merged, initially as a draft, you can do subsequent edits and so on before eventually it gets merged as, as complete but not implemented. The current process then is that it gets discussed at one of the All Core Devs meetings, which are fortnightly and have representatives from all the major Ethereum clients. It gets brought up and discussed, and if there's a consensus there that this is a good improvement and that none of the client implementers are inclined to block its implementation as undoable, for instance, then it gets scheduled into a hard fork. And the client implementers then implement it, they set it up so that it will activate at that hard fork. And then the final step of the process is what I think of as the political step, in that that's the stage at which, you know, the releases of the clients that incorporate this hard fork change are put out. People are informed about what would be contained in this hard fork, although of course that's an ongoing process of communication, what's coming up. And then they have the choice to either run the hard fork client and fork with the people that agree with the hard fork, or not run it and continue with the legacy chain. And normally, ideally, that is a uncontroversial process. When you look at something like Byzantium or Frontier, they're largely crammed with technical upgrades. Nobody has a particularly compelling reason to say, you know, over my dead body. And so that's relatively uncontroversial. Sometimes, in the case of the DAO fork, for instance, that's more controversial, and it can result in anything up to and including the entire community splitting, which I view as something we should strive to avoid because when it's unnecessary, but I also view it as a useful safety valve because it may occur that we want to make a decision about something that we cannot come to unanimous consensus on, and one of the great powers of a blockchain is that you can actually then say, well, you can both have your cake and eat it too. You can, you know, go make your own casino, your own blockchain with your rules, and then you end up with two individual communities, each of which is unanimous on one side of the debate. An important thing there being deciding what the scope of that debate actually was in the first place. But the goal here, at least, is to try and come up with a better way to come to a technical agreement, not political agreement, on how we should standardize improvements to the network and how we should push those forward to make sure they're the best technical agreements that we can possibly have, so the best implementations we can possibly have, and make sure that people who have valid technical objections aren't drowned out by a majority vote, for instance, on the basis that, you know, you're the only one who's seen this problem, therefore you must be wrong. If you haven't read it already, there's an excellent RFC, which I'm sure Greg has either linked in the governance channel or will, about how the IETF comes to consensus. As a very brief introduction, the goal is to seek out disagreement or lack of consensus and then address it by addressing the technical issues. So the IETF uses a form of voting of kinds. They actually come rather than voting. But its goal isn't to determine like the success of a measure by the most people supporting it. It's to find out what objections there are. So an example might be, let's say we're trying to decide whether we should drink Pepsi or Coke. I could ask everyone for a poll of hands of who prefers Coke, and we get some number of hands. Who prefers Pepsi? And a bad decision process would be, okay, more people prefer Coke than Pepsi, we're going with that. A better question would be, who can't tolerate Coke? Who can't tolerate Pepsi? And then look at whichever is the smaller group and start asking the people who can't tolerate Pepsi, why can't you tolerate Pepsi? Is there some way we can resolve this? Obviously, in the case of personal preference, that might not be so easy, but if you can, you're addressing a technical agreement, a technical question, and you try and determine, which side has the fewest objections, that may make it easier to start addressing those objections. You might find that one of those objections is actually fatal to the proposal, and therefore allows you to eliminate the other one entirely. Or it might be that there are minor technical things that could be changed with, with revision. So. The first thing people think of when they hear about, oh, we should standardize coming to consensus, is fancy old blockchain-based voting systems. But it's very much not about that. The votes are really only a way to get an idea of where the consensus is so that we can continue to refine it. Does that seem like a reasonable summary, Greg?
When I was on the C++ committee, some of the working groups, we take straw polls just to see how we were doing. And it was a three-way vote, yes, no, and over my dead bodies.
Yeah, so you've got rough consensus, there's no over my dead bodies.
There were no dead bodies on the working group floors when we were done.
Yes.
But we had two people who quit dramatically because had larger issues, they just thought the language was going in the wrong direction. They were probably right. And tiebreakers went up to votes at the national body level. That was unfortunate when it happened, and it led to bad technical decisions that took years to fix. Voting on technical issues did not work.
So in democracy, they use this concept of tension, where rather than talking about things and everyone kind of brings up their emotions and things they don't like and stuff like that, you start a meeting by thinking about what the tensions of the participants are, and then basically if that person has a tension and a proposal to solve that tension, the group kind of talks about whether that proposal harms the purpose of the organization, and if it doesn't, then that proposal is accepted. There is no vote whatsoever. I'm sure you guys know that. So that's something that worked in my team pretty well. So maybe that could be kind of a little different.
And I think a lot of it is being aware in your own mind and discussing things of the distinction between, I think this is a suboptimal choice or a trade-off that I would make differently, and I think this is a terrible idea that is fatal to the proposal. The IETF also in their sort of TAO document warns against sort of consensus through fatigue. You think you have a valid technical objection, but you spend so much time arguing with people about it and shouting it down that you effectively give up. You say, right, fine, you've made your bed, now lie in it. And warns against that and points out that in that case, the correct thing to do can actually be for somebody else to pick it up and say, I don't think we've resolved this. You know, even if the original person who raised it has walked off and said, I can't take this anymore, we still need to figure out what the correct technical solution is. And the other thing worth mentioning is the IET talks about rough consensus as opposed to absolute consensus. And they view rough consensus as being that there were technical objections that people didn't withdraw, but a majority of the rest of the group decided that they believed those objections had been addressed and or that they were irrelevant. So it's possible for a group to come to rough consensus saying, well, all of us but one are happy with this on technical grounds because we believe that person's objection isn't relevant to this, or because we believe we'd have adequately addressed it. And obviously that's not your ideal outcome, but it also doesn't require unanimity. And in the IETF, the way they handle this, if it really escalates, is that you have a chair who runs the working group, and if you come to rough consensus and a person who rejects still believes that it's sincerely a technical mistake to do so, then they can escalate it to an IETF committee who will go over the whole thing and decide whether the chair, you know, acted incorrectly or not. I feel like, and this is again in the subject of consensus, that Ethereum's process is a little more, well, it's definitely more vague at the moment, but also a little more loose-knit, in that I doubt we're going to appoint a technical committee of people who can overrule consensus. I think the worst case is that we end up with two competing standards, you know, by people with different goals, and that those can then be solved by out-of-band means. I don't think there's necessarily harm in standardising two different versions of the thing. It just means that the decision over which is better becomes an external one. So I agreed to moderate, but that doesn't mean I'm the only person who gets to talk, so.
I seem to recall yesterday I was fairly steamed up, and you just said, well, when they put it on the test map, I'm going to destroy it.
I think that's a bit of an overstatement. I said that if they put it on the testnet and it's broken, then we should find the flaws and then you have an existence proof. You know.
Okay, that's what you said. I'm quite sure when they get it on the testnet that you'll be able to just.
Well, I appreciate the confidence.
That is the running code part is important. So it's not just that we talk, it counts a lot when someone shows up and says, yes, we have this running on the test net. Yes, we have tried to break it. We've tried all the exploits we can think of. We can't seem to make it fall over. And someone else says, well, I have this idea, maybe. The code is running definitely is a better argument. It's not running. And we're in more of a hurry than the IETF is, and the technical consensus is more important. If somebody gets TCPIP sort of wrong on their system, and there's some computers on the network that just aren't working very well, and it doesn't matter that much, except to those computers. But if you have nodes on Ethereum that aren't working very well, that's bad. In the end, our human failure consensus will cause the blockchain to work. So we have this very harsh taskmaster.
On the plus side, it's very measurable.
Yes. We should say probably a little more on process and its vague portions. One stage of the process is simply, creating your proposal. To some extent, that's happening on the issues part of GitHub. Anybody can just make an issue and start discussions there, and people do. And you can also start discussing on any other forum in the world. And I'd like, you know, more support there because the issues aren't, this is not the best place to do it necessarily. Yeah, it's helpful, it's a place, but you need others. And I'd like to see more support for people to reach out, find other people with interest in that, and more help. Because people can wind up just working alone, not knowing what to do, and there could be other people in the community that know a lot about it and can help. So that's the support to get to the point of having done the PR. And then when the PR comes in, more support in perfecting it and dealing with the criticism that's coming in. And simply understanding that a PR is just a PR. I mean, recently, you know, had a huge amount of conflict on Pfeiffer and Levy's proposal for how to recover funds that have just been stranded on the blockchain. You know, it's like a diamond ring at the bottom of the wishing well. You're looking down, and there it is. And we have to have an argument as to whether we can legitimately fish it back out again. And that's not an argument that should even happen at that stage. We're simply making technical proposals, and the EIP editors, it's not our job to decide whether this is a good thing to do. All we can decide is this technically possible, and is this a technically sound proposal? So part of what I'm wanting to see happen is to, as much as possible, you know, carve out a space for technical discussion. And I saw arguments on there where people were saying, I don't even want to see a proposal that hints that it might be possible. You know, my attitude is like, you can pretend there's no gravity, but you're still going to fall down.
And I think it's worth amplifying that's why that's a good idea, why the ideas should be about taking a discussion and not about political agreement. And the reason is that there's nothing in the way Ethereum is set up that requires hard forks to be standardized through EIPs. If we make certain things undiscussable, or if we make the agreement on the implementation a prerequisite for actually even writing a standard, then if the process becomes sufficiently broken like that, people will just go off and standardize these controversial things elsewhere. There's nothing authoritative about an EIP except that people agree to read it and follow it. And you know, any client, any user could implement any change they like to the network based on their own standardization system if they wanted. So we keep the standardization process as useful as possible and as valuable as possible by restricting ourselves in that aspect to technical development, in my opinion.
Then the next point, where it's really pretty vague, I think, if you read EIP-1, is it's the core developers who ultimately decide what goes in to a hard fork, because they have to write the code that goes into the clients. If there's no client to run, it can't happen. And the EIP process really is just input to the core developers. As you were saying, other people can provide input in other ways. And we don't really have a stage in the EIP process beyond just getting a PR merged. So a responsibility we could take on is that as a group, we have not just said it's technically sound, but we've more come to a consensus that we actually think this should go into a hard fork, or at least this is a technically sound proposal that could go into a hard fork. Without creating any technical issues. And if there are political issues, pass it on. And somebody else has got to figure that out. It's a very hard problem. I don't know how to solve it. All we can do is provide, you know, technical input to that. And so there's some political things where you could say, well, we may want that, technically, it's just not doable. Or we may say, technically, it's dead simple. You decide whether you want to do it. You might have to hire lawyers, I don't know.
And it can be difficult because often the benefits are politically political as well. If you look at the fund recovery proposal, technically it's straightforward. Politically, the from a purely technical point of view, there's no reason you'd implement it in that its benefits arrive for people, not for the system. It makes the system a little bit more complicated, and it doesn't provide extra capabilities to the network. But it has other considerations that, you know, depending on your opinion on the governance of the blockchain, may be relevant. So it's difficult and impossible to assess whether something should be included purely based on its merit in some cases. You know, it's clearer in others.
How would you address the potential bias that might occur if you've done all the work to evaluate a proposal, even if you have working code, even? Don't you think that might create a...
It does, yeah. The
investment bias.
Yeah.
How would you counter that? How might we address that?
I have a suggestion that I think might be useful in these types of situations to specifically promote this sentiment around AIPs. It might be nice to have the standard EIP format include an explicit disclaimer at the top that says this proposal is in technical analysis. It's at this stage, and perhaps once technical people start to signal that the technical analysis is finished, then you can mark your disclaimer and say, now the purpose is for other people to go and resolve the other issues. Like just some sort of direct verbal thing, because one of the unique challenges of the Ethereum community is that it is possible for many members of the community to interact with the topic without ever encountering each other's ideas, simply by being linked directly to something. And just a direct verbal disclaimer at the top of something can actually be quite helpful in setting expectations. One other thing that I haven't heard so far in the discussion that is a distinct challenge for this community is that in blockchains and crypto economics in general, unlike in other technologies, economic interest is not just something that motivates people to prefer or oppose something, but it's also a technical characteristic of the network. It presents a distinct challenge in considering all of these topics as well. So like the final phase that I would add on to the end of Nick's story, what I had a hard fork is, and then the market decides what to value the various networks at,
yes.
And those consequences directly correspond to the security that results in those systems.
And theoretically, roughly, give you some indication of the usefulness of the network, or at least what other people think the usefulness of the network will be. I think it's definitely worth pointing out that, as you say, or my version of what you say, that economic interests distort everything. They're like gravity in a technical discussion, and it makes our life a lot more difficult than the IETFs for that reason. So I guess in the interests of establishing consensus, do people generally agree that it's worth having an EIP process that is purely focused on technical agreement and leaves the political arguments of adoption as an externality? I guess the better question is, who has an objection to that idea and believes it should be modified? Now is that
well,
yes.
A question, I guess. So I think the vision says keep Ethereum the best it can technically be, where technology always follows like a certain purpose that is in us as like individuals, so we have common values or something like that. And as you say, there's these economic incentives for everyone, and then just think idea, if we don't know what we want, then it will kind of fall apart. So I think we should, I'm not sure, but there needs to be a purpose that is beyond, like, we just want to be technically good, because in the worst case, that just leads to, like, keeping it very safe and very stable, and it will become a sitting duck a bit more.
Yes.
And then you get overtaken. So I think there needs to be something in the purpose which aligns with values, not on just saying, like, we want stable technology.
Otherwise, we could end up being the best music sharing network in the world, even though that was never our goal, you're saying, effectively.
Yeah, absolutely. Or, yeah, so, fastest trading.
Yeah, so we need to be more specific about what we want to be technically good at.
I think so.
Any suggestions? Do we want to be the best music sharing network in the world?
I couldn't quite hear that.
I believe the point was that it's not enough to say that we want to be as technically good as possible. We need to say about what, because if you don't, then we can all have different visions. It's like what you were talking about earlier with not even having a requirements document. We don't actually know what we want to be technically good at, and we can end up pulling it across purposes to build different things rather than because we disagree on how to build the thing.
Very difficult question.
Yeah.
I mean, it's maybe ambiguous in the same way as the Ethereum philosophy, in line with the Ethereum philosophy piece.
Yes. I really hope we can agree on what Ethereum should do more easily than we can agree on what its philosophy is, because otherwise we might be doomed. But does anyone think they have a good preciseness of what Ethereum is?
Well, that's bad.
Yeah, ironically, a consensus system. in my mind, it's a general purpose platform for trustless computing and for coming to distributed agreements without trusted parties. But that's also still very broad. There are many ways you could take that and try and improve it. And I think thus far, the sort of gestalt of the VIPs and hard forks has been general improvements in ways that make that more useful to everyone without making it more specific. Although you could point to things like ZK Snarks and say these are kind of specific. The goal has mostly been to make it more useful to a wide variety of applications rather than focusing on one thing.
A more indirect goal is simply that people know each other better, talk to each other more. And some of this is never, philosophy doesn't get written down, it emerges from knowing each other and coming to, it can be sort of vague, but it's there. And as long as we're just scattered around the world, not even knowing each other, it gets harder. As you say, it's a very general purpose philosophy. You can do anything with the internet, people do. And I don't think the ITF worries, a whole lot as to whether the internet is mainly a medium for distributing news or porn.
But we have some agreement that the internet is a medium for carrying traffic.
Yes.
And that we shouldn't make technical changes to the internet that make it better at one sort of traffic at the expense of others, I think.
Exactly. Being generic is also a goal. Can it be a decision? Not being generic can be a goal.
Yeah. So does anyone think that's an accurate vision of where Ethereum is headed? Or what it's against the plan? This is where the humming comes in useful, I guess, because it's been today to be the only person to raise your hand. So I guess that's our direction, tentatively.
Why don't you explain the humming? Did you see it at the ITF when you went?
I haven't been to an ITF yet. I'm actually, the next one's in London and I'm attending that.
It's
pretty silly.
Yeah.
As I understand it, it's not totally universal, but it's a way of establishing like how many people agree or disagree with the proposition without the sort of, like, raising hands tends to encourage people to treat it as a vote, and it also tends to encourage people to focus on the people who you know, were for or against certain things rather than the value of the proposals themselves. So the IETF, it's a bit weird, uses humming instead. So it asks people to hum for or against something and then uses the volume of that to sort of assess where the technical position is, you know, where what things need addressing. And yeah, just again, it's like it's all about finding the disagreements and addressing them rather than majority rules or majority vote. It's a problem that the IETF also deals with to some degree, in that there's no membership group, and there isn't here either in the Ethereum Foundation or the Ethereum Magicians. So you can't meaningfully hold a vote when you don't know who the people who can vote are, you don't know when you've reached a majority. So even if it was a good idea, you don't have a well-defined group, so you can't actually say, you know, 53% of people thought this was a good idea. And we see that in the process with people with GitHub and so on, brigading, you know, effectively just lots of people being encouraged to come in and express one opinion because they've been told to by somebody else without entering the technical discussion. And in the rough consensus process, 10,000 voices saying the same thing should hold roughly the same weight as one. You know, what should matter is whether they're raising a useful point or not. You stretching, or did you want to say something?
No, no. I think I don't have a particular solution to it other than to say it's I think everybody's responsibility. If we have broad consensus on what this process should look like, and I'm just going to protect the consensus first, then it's everyone's responsibility to kind of self-please and be willing to say, regardless of what your opinion on the optimal adoption of a particular proposal should be, to say, when someone comes in and there's maybe some graffiti going on or people coming in and they're not making the technical argument or just expressing an opinion, to say, look, this is not the time, this is not the place for that. I think the more we do that, the more that will become part of the culture, and we won't have to do it as much if people understand that, you know, GitHub is problematic in some sense with the emojis and things that, and there's other practical issues like with the without it being merged, there wasn't a direct way for people to look easily at what the actual proposal was. So when you come to the page, you're immediately confronted first with the emojis and people's comments, and you look at the ones that get the most thumbs up, or you know, those are the ones that stand out, but they may not have any bearing on the technical part of the issue. So I think, you know, being willing to comment on those issues and say, hey, this is not the time for this, but make clear that there is a time for those opinions and for those judgments, but it's not here. Then maybe we can it's very difficult to even read through the threads that happen on GitHub when there is maybe some technical discussion going on, but it's separated by 15, you know, this is a terrible idea, or please do this because I lost whatever, you know. So I think if we can keep it more focused, then it will be easier. But there may be that there's just, GitHub doesn't have to be the tool if we find that it is problematic for having extended technical conversation. For instance, you mentioned that for the Ethereum Magicians, you can have this threaded discussion board. I think that makes a lot of sense because you've got several technical issues and you just have to keep scrolling down. Things get lost, things are out of context, you have to keep copying and pasting the comments back into your responses. So I think there may be a better place for those discussions to happen.
Yeah. Jim?
Yeah, just to add on that, probably what GitHub Maintainer 2 has like a difficulty, since you don't have threading, you always have this long list of comments. Probably a better way to address the technicality of it is just to go to the PR, to the code, and just like add more comments. So you won't have the emotional aspect of like, okay, I don't like this PR because this or that, I just don't like this part of code because like introducing this vulnerability or whatever, or it doesn't make sense with the vision of the project or whatever. So maybe that's kind of the solution. Just to keep it more technical.
I have a question about this, because at the beginning it happened also on the home in GitHub. They get so low there and they get this interactivity that is possible. So what I see people don't like when people are regaining access to the plugin in the body, can we so is it possible to actually moderate it or do the same don't moderate it? Not enforce
it? The editors I believe have the ability to delete comments on GitHub. I'm not sure whether that's the ideally we want a way to moderate the discussion without censoring it. One of the ways that ATF handles this is they have a chair and an editor for each of the group, and the chair's job is to seek consensus, and that means they maintain basically a list of outstanding objections and of outstanding discussions, and having that person do that on its or something similar to it needs may make it a lot easier to avoid being sidetracked by engaging and by continuous objection or upvotes or whatever, simply by having them able to constantly update and hear the things we still need to address to reach people in census. And they also have the editor who, in principle, the same person, and their job is to keep the actual draft and stand it up to date with the current establishment. I simply feel like at least the first role would be really valuable here in clarifying what the discussion is still about, because it's extremely easy to be sidetracked.
I think a moderator within the EIP is helpful in that discussion.
Yes.
There's a person responsible for it to maintain order and to summarize the state, the consensus state.
Yes.
So it's kind of issues within the issues.
And in fact, the way the ITF runs RFCs is a lot larger in scope than what we do here. Like here, an EAP is an issue or a pull request or a linear series of pull requests. In an ITF working group, each individual standard has its own discussion forum and often it has its own issue tracker. And the chair, helps maintain the issue tracker, which has a list of all the outstanding technical issues being addressed. So these are tools maybe within here, and of course also a lot of the standards we're writing are a lot smaller and a lot simpler than the RFCs, and that may be an unwarranted level over here for just for standardizing some basic or one function contract interface or something like that. But it also that sort of separation makes it easier because you want to disagree with something, well state your technical objection and not an issue. Can't find out an issue, create one, and if your objection doesn't fit that, then maybe it's not relevant to take the consensus.
Well, viewers are about to become incentive, and what you can add to get rid of threshold of communication and move people to the right things even better that they are good right is like building on the system. Similar to Steam, maybe, but inside the technical discussion of everything.
Could you describe that a little bit better? I can I don't fully understand.
Like, do you understand how the economic model inside Steam works?
No.
If someone writes anything, yes. Actually, people vote for his not just with likes, but with actual money they want to send him. And on the contrast, when people write bad comments, they have their ratings downloaded, and that in turn will influence how much money they can get from writing second post from something valuable. This is how you regulate the community and what it tries with the ground consensus. It may be little, but it's still interesting the way people think about what they're writing.
So the problem here is that if you're trying to build the best standard and continue with you, the number of people who object to you and how much money they're willing to throw at it doesn't necessarily reflect how valid the objection is. If somebody wants to build a new proof of work algorithm and I say this is broken because I can demonstrate that it's broken, then it shouldn't matter, you know, how many people think that's an unpleasant opinion for me to have, or that, you know, they disagree that they don't want to be the case and still object to be the case. And so that's the risk of trying to build any like a crypto economic system to come to consensus, is that you actually overcome consensus on opinion rather than fact. Voting on the best cancer treatments doesn't actually arrive at the best cancer treatments, it just arrives at the ones that are the most popular. Or, you know, letting the family vote on what to have for dinner, and funnily enough, we always end up eating nothing for dessert because there's three kids, only two adults. Which is a bad metaphor, because I'm not trying to suggest that some participants are that children with no foresight. I'm just suggesting that what matters is the objective arguments for why we should do a thing, and not
I think one other topic that hasn't come up here yet that's very important in open communities is the differentiation between before and after. So when you have a technical community and you make a proposal about something that has not yet affected a large number of people, there is a much easier opportunity for, you know, a bunch of technical contributors to work and find a solution that's based primarily on technical merit. And if you encounter a situation that has already begun to impact a large number of people, it is in some sense impossible to just look completely at very neutral technical assessment of everything, because even the technical people who are involved will have other incentives driving them and things like this. And I think just being aware that technical consensus is harder after than before has to be an important consideration in anything. Like, for example, building a requirements document for Ethereum is exactly the sort of thing that would have been easier before, is now more difficult after. That's just a reality of open communities. There are different techniques that you sometimes have to bring in after than what you could have been able to work with before, just because of the many additional interests that become involved.
And I feel like the reason that happens is that effectively any variable in your community you don't constrain before building the system will take a variety of values afterwards. So if you build the system with a particular design constraint or a particular philosophy, and I think Bitcoin versus Ethereum is the perfect example here, because Bitcoin was not built with a philosophy that hard forks would be an extended future thing for network upgrades. And so the community contains people with a variety of opinions on that, and that makes it difficult or impossible to come to consensus on. Ethereum ab initio was created with the expectation of future technical upgrade hard forks, and as a result, everyone who joined the community came with that expectation, and therefore it's a version, or at least relatively so. And so I think the same applies to building individual standards and so on. Anything you don't constrain at your time, you can expect there to be people with all opinions on it, and that makes it much, much harder.
Brings up a few thoughts by now. Yuta's comment on staying civilized, flame wars are legendary on the internet ever since there's been an internet. Yeah, just the mere fact of having regular face-to-face meetings helps a lot. Yeah, once you start to know people personally, you're much less likely to flame them on the internet. And in this community, a lot of people like to be anonymous, and they'll even use different tags on different channels. So I've sometimes spent months corresponding with what I thought was three different people, and they were actually one person. And sometimes I still don't know who that person is. So it's just the fact of having a fellowship means there's a fellowship and a sense of shared mission, even when we disagree with each other. There's some degree of friendship there that helps a lot. Simply being able to present technical alternatives to the community means you can actually have a meaningful discussion where the technical alternatives are clear, and you can discuss the philosophical, financial, political, legal, the many other issues that are going to come up without getting down a rat hole of technical issues as well, and discuss the technical issues without getting down the rat holes of non-technical issues. And a much more general comment, a lot of people have no idea how decentralized this is. I'll talk to people who seem to think that the foundation runs and owns Ethereum. It doesn't. It has some trademarks, it has a lot of influence, but it doesn't run Ethereum. Part of what I like to see here is a center of gravity for developers that is accountable to developers, accountable to us, not accountable to the foundation, not accountable to whatever company we happen to work for or don't work for. Nobody's paid me a penny to do anything for Ethereum for many months now. I'm sure a lot of us here are in that situation. I'm sure most of us here don't work for the foundation. And in such a community, people just stand up to do a job. The EIP editors are not paid or authorized by anyone to do what we do. We've simply chosen to do it, and if we do it well, it's a valuable input for developers in choosing what goes into the clients. I think there's issues with the core developers, but those issues they're going to have to work out for themselves and with the community. But that's the general comment I want to make, that we're simply standing up to say we want to organize as developers to have more of a fellowship to represent ourselves within the community and sort of dispel this notion that there's some central authority that's doing this, because there isn't.
And could you talk a little about how you envisage future meetings going? Like, here we're sort of misunderstanding, effectively trying to write ourselves a constitution for Ethereum magicians, or at least a set of ground rules and how we expect to operate. How would you see future meetings running? What would be the main topics and mm-hmm. how would they operate?
Ordinarily, groups of people sort of create working groups, and the working groups organize themselves, and somehow somebody volunteers and people accept that, we'll let you volunteer to organize things, and we're letting you more or less run the meeting. And I seem to have a little bit more privilege to break in than other people do, although I'd like to back out of that over time, because nobody's paying me to do this, and I can't necessarily afford to travel the world for very long. I'm only a thousandaire, I'm not a millionaire. Those thousands aren't going to last very long.
I'm just just curious about kind of the process for how EIP editors get chosen, or how that or how it happens.
I have no idea.
Yeah, I'm not much wiser either. Basically, the process about 9 months to a year ago was pretty stagnant. There was one nominal EIP editor, and they have been pretty long. Hudson revised the process. You can help us revise each one of those to make it clearer how things should work, although it's still pretty vague. And a bunch of us basically appointed ourselves as editors with, you know, consensus in the group, basically. And part of that took place inside the year just because Hudson was, and therefore it's a matter of like what communication channels were, that it was easy to find and talk to. I guess I'd emphasize that the editors are supposed to be like an administrative position. They're not deciders except in terms of, is this stable? You know, should this be merged? Because, you know, it's not going to change every 30 seconds. But yes, it's a very good question. How do we appoint the editors on an ongoing basis?
If you want to volunteer.
Well, should I be benevolent to take for life the editor appointment?
Well, I'm not on the list of editors, but I have right privileges to the repo. So, given that I have right privileges to the repo,
I think that makes you an editor effectively.
Right. I could go in and put myself onto that topic, but that might expose me to more hassle than I want to be exposed to. Probably the most important order of business is just, do we want to have a meeting in July? And who works for an organization or is in a position to beg for money to support that? And given who is in a position to beg for money to support that, when and where should it happen? And that would probably be a better meeting at which to get, you know, more organized as far as what are the working groups, who are the chairman, you know, who's going to be volunteered to take on the pain of being president. There's a saying in Alcoholics Anonymous, which goes way back, and it's another decentralized organization, which says, how's it go? Our leaders are but servants. They do not govern. And it's that sort of thing. If even if you're the president, you have very little power. You just take on a lot of work.
And I think it's worth noting too that like people, like groups like the IETF and that are Alcoholics Anonymous doing decentralized governance for a lot longer than Ethereum or Bitcoin around. And the IETF in particular has some really good documents about how they do it, and I think we learn a lot from how they've managed to build the internet effectively, you know, without coming into screaming fits and going off and making two different internets, you know, each with their own different supporters.
Another good general point to reach that my mentor taught me. A lot of people don't know that my PhD is actually in psychology. And back then, I think to this day, cognitive psychology pretends that the brain is some sort of computer or some sort of software that runs on that computer. You can agree or disagree, but I think that's complete nonsense. So I left that field and took all of the things I learned about computer science and became a computer scientist, because computers are computers. They do run software. But anyway, in a good negotiation, two people don't just argue at each other. In a good negotiation, each person argues both sides. The person who has a different idea, you start going, well, you know, given your idea, I think about this. This would be a good argument for your idea. And they should be able to say, well, no, actually, I see a hole in that. You know, it should not be this fight. it's a cooperative effort to come up with the, you know, the best formulation of the idea. And you can then come forward with two different ideas, both of them well formulated. And it really should be that sort of cooperative effort. It doesn't have to be a fight. Fight can be later when politics start.
Maybe Casper's been a good example of that. Going, well, what's happening? You've got Vitalik's Casper and you've got Vlad's Casper. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen?
And then well, people who are like, should we even have Casper? And fortunately, we're deciding to answer that once we have a Casper to have or not.
Then you work through the ideas until then.
Yeah.
Okay. So we may never have a Casper.
I don't know.
I used to worry about the wasted energy, and then in an airline magazine coming over here of all places, I discovered there's actually a whole ring of towns in the Arctic who have almost unlimited hydropower, which is so far away from anywhere they can't make any use of it. They can't get it to anywhere. And it's very cold, so they have almost unlimited refrigeration. and they're setting up mining farms. And so in fact, it's not a big problem. They can just keep doing proof of work, and they've got plenty of electricity and plenty of cooling. And they're going, what do we need proof of stake for? So if we never get around to Casper, it may not be a problem at all.
But this just applies for this cold area, not for the whole world.
No, they can easily get the bits out. They just can't get mass quantities of electricity anywhere else. So they might as well just use it up there for proof of work.
Sure. So on governance, like my understanding is that indeed there is a the possibility to enter and participate is, the barrier is very low, but like in this discussion, it has been centered around like a few people who have been known to the community and everything. So like how, I believe there is a lack of education for the people in order to get involved in this part. Mm-hmm. And maybe a small lack of incentives, like why would I even bother if somebody who is possibly more educated than I would do it? Mm-hmm. So how would you address that if you want to truly govern by the people system?
Here you are.
Yeah, I agree, but this is just, I know, 50, 60 of us. And so far, 8 people maybe talked.
You're talking now?
Sure.
Well, let's have some more people talk.
In that sense, I mean that some people who are already know, so on GitHub, anybody can raise an issue, but usually it's, from what I've seen at least, it's usually the people who are well known that have their voices are louder than the others. And I don't think that you can necessarily avoid this, and that it's totally a bad thing, but in order to level the field, maybe there could be some way to open this up to more people.
Well, I think having a chair who keeps track of disagreements and of technical issues can help with that, because if you raise a technical issue, and your chair is doing their job, they should help make sure that gets resolved, even if you're new to the community and have no standing there. In theory, whether that works in practice, of course, is another matter.
There's a concept called brain writing, which is I agree with what you're saying. There's an effect when people sit around in a room like this, people are, you know, afraid to raise their voices or you know, shy or maybe, you know, overwhelmed or something or embarrassed. But people, there should be a period where people submit objections and ideas before, like maybe online through a forum, maybe even anonymously or pseudonymously, and then we have that list, and then when we come together, that list is already there. It also prevents people biasing other people in the room.
I think people are also very often not strongly opinionated, so personally I just find participating in a discussion where all the arguments were presented by both sides pointless, because I can read, you know, the arguments of both sides, so I can, I don't know, add thumbs up or like whatever, and then just continue doing my work. So there's no point in expressing and voicing my point if it's been already expressed, and I'm also not a person who would ever say over my dead body. So, you know, it's just, I think that there are a lot of people like that who are not strongly opinionated, and they just prefer to work instead of arguing.
So I think we're starting to run out of time if people want to make it to other things. So maybe we should try and come to consensus on a few things before we just...
The most important thing is, do we want to meet in July, and who's going to volunteer to try to make that happen?
We would volunteer. Web3 Foundation can host in Berlin. There's a lot of projects in Berlin, so we'd be happy to secure a venue.
I couldn't hear you.
We'd be happy to secure a venue and facilitate.
Okay, who's
in Berlin, Web3 Foundation, but we would collaborate with anyone else who's in Berlin.
Okay, anyone else?
Maybe first by capital, but who, based on the discussion here, thinks that a fellowship of American magicians is useful and valuable? Hopefully lots of people. Yeah, who thinks it's a terrible idea? Well, we came to consensus on something here. Who here would be interested in attending an event in July in Berlin to continue this conversation? I mean, obviously online as well, but yeah, that sounds like it. Okay, who absolutely couldn't make it? Right, well, I guess I'll see you all in Berlin.
And if you'd like to stay in this room, we have a workshop with Dmitry Kolkov on consensus testing.
Try to arrange the chairs just a little bit.